Gig Gab, the Working Musicians Podcast, episode 169 for Monday, June 11th, 2018. Folks, and welcome to Gig Gab, the podcast by, for, and about working musicians here back in Durham, New Hampshire. I'm Dave Hamilton.
Here still in Los Gatos, California, it's Paul Kent.
How you doing, Mr. Kent?
I'm good. It was nice to see you this week, man. It was very brief, but it was nice to see you. You got to see my band play.
I got to see you and the House Rockers kick ass for a night. Yeah, it was a pleasure. Really a pleasure.
Thank you, man.
Yeah,
Thank you.
Guys are great. Really. That's the best I've ever seen you. Well, just the most energetic. I mean, you had a good crowd, right? You had a really drunk crowd. Let's be perfectly honest. that's how it goes. And then they were very enthusiastic. That was, moments of fear of not being, behind the invisible fourth wall of the stage like you were, because I was out amongst the mayhem. But for the most part, people were fine and very enthusiastic. And you guys fed right off of that and delivered it, too. I mean, it was, it was that whole thing we always talk about, folks, where, you got to give the energy from the stage in order to get it back. And then it becomes this flowing thing. And then you guys delivered a masterclass on that. So it was great.
Well, thank you, man. It was a lot of fun. It was great to have you there. You know, obviously, I would be lying if I didn't say a large part of my headspace was, I wonder what Dave's thinking about this as we're going along.
Yeah, I know. It sucks, doesn't it? Having like a friend or, somebody that is out there thinking about everything that's going on.
Yeah,
that sucks. But no, I enjoyed the heck out of it. And, I told you this that night, but the harmonies that you guys had going, like the intonation on them was stellar. You really were locked in together in some really great ways. So,
it's all about being able to hear the subtlety, right? This
totally.
Is like,
yep.
You can't that I would imagine that's kind of hard to do with wedges with general stage sound. This is where Nick is very in tune to it, but actually Nick is kind of what we all intonate to, right? He's spot on. Mm. And so as long as we can hear Nick, you can kind of feel where your harmony goes.
That makes sense.
But hearing like real subtleties, that's being able to hear yourself. At least for me, that's being able to hear yourself. And it was a loud room. It was a big sound system. It was a loud stage. Man, the bass was thumping on stage. I mean, it was like,
I don't know why they had the low end up as loud as they did, but that's fine. Yeah. Yeah. So that's how it goes. That's how it goes in those rooms. Yeah.
It is how it goes in those rooms. So anyway, it was cool to spend some time with you, get a little brief meal and get reconnected. And it was fun for me to play for you. So that was cool. I'm glad you liked it.
Yeah, it was a blast. You guys are great. And it was great to see, after all of our discussions here about Russ, your new drummer, it was great to see him play. So
he's really good, isn't he?
He's great. Yeah. Yeah. In talking to him, he doesn't give himself nearly enough credit.
He's a very, very humble guy.
Yeah. But there's an interesting thing there. Like it's something like not having any humility is, I think, a bad thing. Right. But there can be a scenario where you have too much. I'm not convinced he has too much. He may be overplaying it, overstating it with just when he speaks. But you got to be careful. Like you need to, especially a drummer. Like you got to hit the stage with confidence that you're going to carry this band, right? And at some level you have to believe it. I think
Russ is, he is a confident musician.
Correct.
He is genuinely humble. I think the thing is, we've approached that Nirvana thing where, he really feels like he's given the band what he can give them on a full show basis. We had a great club date a week ago, which was from Downbeat to the End, was really fun. And we've had a lot of good moments, but knowing as much about Russ as I do, I think that's mostly his expectation about what he wants to bring to the band. So, one small, I don't even call it a flub, but one small moment that's not what he expected it to be. Knowing Russ well enough, he'll always say, "I can do better,"
and he'll beat
that's kind of
up.
A lot of what you were feeling. Yeah,
yeah, yeah. And, well,
we're going to ruin him on that because I call songs and I just like, do you know this song? I heard it before. I just follow along. That's not what I think he does a whole lot of, or has been doing a whole lot of.
Right. And
so I'm going to shake him a little bit as time goes on, because he's a fantastic musician and he's really fun to play with and he's really fun to be in a band with. So
I bet
we're going to actually watch the Warriors play tonight and hopefully win a championship. And just getting that social time with him is really fun for me, because I knew of him for a long time before he joined the band.
Sure.
And we've spent a fair amount of time since he's joined the band, but you know, really getting that thing where he reacts to everything I do on stage, that's a chemistry thing. That's a, yes, that's a getting to know people thing. Yep. And so I think that the offstage stuff really helps with that stuff.
Oh, it definitely does. Yeah. Yeah. You're right. It's interesting, because I've been in the scenario that Russ is in many times, and there's two parts to it, right? The chemistry, the trust, knowing that, you know, when I make a mistake, it's not, oh man, there's that guy over there that we don't really know. And he just, like, you know, in some way, hopefully not a huge way, you know, screwed up this song that we're playing. Like, that's very different than, Dave messed up that thing. Right. You know, and that has to happen on two levels, right? It has to happen in everyone in the band's minds, but then it also has to happen in my head, or in your case, you know, in the case of the House Rockers, in Russ's head, where there's that trust of, yeah, I can screw something up and we're going to look at each other and laugh. And yes, and move on, right? And it's, yes, okay. Even
when
though
you're the new guy, you're sensitive that the flubs are, you know, are end of game type things. And correct. But when the trust is already there,
yep,
and you realize everybody has their moments during a gig, you know, well, good and it. Bad. So,
and you gotta have enough gigs.
That's good analysis.
You gotta have enough gigs to where everybody's had their moments, right? It's like, okay, yeah, you know, that guy screwed up this, that guy screwed up that, or whatever. And also, you know, having material that you're playing that you all learned together, or didn't learn.
Like
together.
Do I Do is one. That was right. The song Russ actually brought in. And that was one we all started from, you know, the first rehearsal to, and you know, that we played an OAR song called, Wonderful Day. You know, these are all, you know, we actually have, you know, a fair amount, you know, you heard us play Tears of a Clown.
Yep.
You know, a few other things. Those were ones, and you can tell Russ is right there with us.
You
He's
can
in the
totally,
exact same amount of familiarity.
Yeah, I could tell. I mean, and this is where it's like, and I say this about him only because I saw it, but I am fully guilty of the same thing, which is why it's so, you know, palpable for me, is like the tunes that, you know, you guys knew and he came in and had to learn either the song or at least your arrangement of the song or whatever. You know, he's really intent on getting it right. Whereas the ones that you either played together and rehearsed together, or when you had Jim Dalrymple, the host of the party, come up and play some tunes, you know, you were some of those, you were much looser. Yeah. It was like, we're going to hack our way through this. And, but then we're all at the same level, right? Everybody on this, I say we, but you know, at that moment it was you guys, right? But everybody's at the same level and the confidence is there. And it's just like harnessing And it's really hard, really, really hard as the quote unquote new guy in the band to harness that confidence that you know you
just
have.
It just takes time, man.
It just takes time
to
yeah.
build trust.
Yeah. Yeah. It's tough. It's tough. But, but yeah, no, I was really impressed. I really blown away. Yeah. It was fun to watch. Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, thanks, Dave.
You guys definitely had
more
energy than the crowd, which is good. This is no joke, and I'm not doing this just to butter you up, but it reminded me of the first time that I saw Extreme. It was down in Austin. It was when they were, you know, I don't know, this was like 20 something years ago or whatever. I mean, they were, you know, they were working hard and, you know, out there trying to prove something every night, which actually I think that band does every night anyway. And I'll never forget them asking the crowd, like, do you guys have, you know, any energy left? Like, we want to keep playing, but, you know, you guys got to step up and join us, you know, and Gary Cherone is a very, you know, dominant force when he's on stage like that. It was like, yes, sir. You know, we're here. But I definitely felt that same kind of thing. Like, you guys were ready to rock and the crowd was, you know, like starting to
thin. It was 9-1 guys to girls,
yes,
was one thing.
And exactly.
So it wasn't going to be a dancing night, but then, you know,
it turned into one though.
Like,
yeah, it was good.
It did.
I want to talk about our sponsor, Simple Contacts, Paul. If you visit simplecontacts.com/ And use coupon code GigGab. I always got to get it right. You save, or you can visit simplecontacts.com/giggab. I knew we could do either one. You save $30 off your first order of contacts. This is the cool, and contact lenses, of course, is what I mean. This is one of the coolest things I've ever done. And I think you did it too. Our wives wear contacts. And, you know, normally in order to get a new batch of contacts, you got to go to the doctor, you got to spend time, you got to spend money, and usually a lot of money, a couple $100 for a doctor's appointment or whatever, just to get your new order of contacts. Well, this solves that problem because you get to do your vision test, right? It doesn't take the place of your whole, you know, full eye health exam, but it does a vision test right there, either on your computer or on an app on your phone, and confirms that your vision is what it is. You put your contacts in, you do the vision test, and then you use their little app to scan the barcode on your existing lenses, and it matches exactly with those, and then you order your lenses. And not only do you save $30 using coupon code GigGab, you save a ton of money because Simple Contacts pricing is way better than anything my wife has found before. Really, really cool service. Well done. So you got to check it out. Go to simplecontacts.com/giggab and or use coupon code GigGab at checkout and you'll save $30 on this great service. And our thanks to Simple Contacts for sponsoring this episode.
Absolutely.
Yeah. Yep. So what's the topic, Paul?
So I have this premise because I played a gig on Saturday, a week ago, Saturday night, June 2nd. Okay. I played this Fogarty gig where I was just a guy in the band, which was a whole series of great emotions just to be able to, you know, just play guitar and not have to have any responsibility of being a good guitar player.
Blissful, isn't it? Yeah.
Blissful, man. Absolutely. But the thing is, this was another one of these special gigs. So, you know, I started this, I did a Springsteen gig last year.
Yeah.
I followed that with a Petty tribute, you know, after that. And then I just did another big Springsteen gig and I've convinced Steve and Mary Ellen, who are in my band, my harmony trio, Acoustic Madness, that these are really good things. They're good things on many levels. They're good things as a performer to take the stage when, you know, 100, 200 people are facing you and it's up to you to give them an evening of entertainment, different than a bar band gig.
Sure.
And we're going to talk about that in a second. It's good for your musical community. These are different types of gigs that get out there. It's good for the music consumer. And that's actually what I really want to talk about most is this went over great and they've all gone over, all four that I mentioned have gone over great and people really seem to appreciate it. And it dawns on me that, you know, especially as someone who fronts a band, you're creating some kind of community around your band. That's your goal. You know, you want to get right. Some kind of a fan base, you get a fan base, you can take that fan base to places, you can, you know, raise your prices, you can feel the love when you're playing. There's all sorts of great benefits about developing a fan base. That's what it's about. These types of special shows are really cool. And the amount of love that was coming back at Steve, my buddy Steve, who did the Fogarty, yep. And certainly came to me when I did the other ones. You know, music lovers love music. And I thought it'd be interesting to kind of dive into, at least from your and my, the musician's perspective, about what is probably going on with those types of people who want to come see you. And there's all sorts of different perspectives to this. You know, there are people who go to bar gigs looking for love. There are people who really have found some meaning, and no matter what level of musician you are, find some connection and meaning to what you're doing for them, right? You caught them at a difficult time in their life and you played a song that resonates with them. They're yours, you know?
Yeah.
You now have a relationship with those people. And I was thinking that this show, these formats where they're more listening formats. Now, every single one of them turned into somewhat of a dance thing at the end, the energy build, you know, that's certainly the way I wrote my set list. That's certainly the way Steve wrote his set list. The energy builds and, you know, big endings with big famous songs that really send people home rocking and they're out of their seats if you do it right. But, you know, having that kind of a environment where a lot of people, you know, a club date is a thing, right? You go to a club, it's noisy. You're fighting to get a drink, you know, you get your time with the bartender, you know, it's about the dancing often. It's about the, you know, people looking for each other. That's one vibe. I'm not going to say good or bad. I'm just going to say that's just one vibe. That's what a bar gig is, right?
Totally agreed. Yep. It's what a bar
gig is. But these gigs were about, like, I want to pass on some emotional transaction with you. I want to give you some entertainment. And if I do it right and it means something with you, we're both going to have kind of a thing. That's another type of experience that a lot of times people who, you know, they go to bars because they like you. They go to bars because they want to get out for an evening, or they have friends in town, or whatever those reasons are. But I just want to, like, hold up to the light that the value of you as a musician, you as a front person, you as an accompanist, side person, you know, that very raw personal exchange of some music, some emotion to someone else. It means one thing in one format. It means other things in other formats. I can say from my personal example, I'm finding a lot of reward when I get to do these solo acoustic shows. I'm doing one in a coffee shop now in town, Los Gatos Coffee Roasting, and it's a quiet night and everybody's facing me and I have to, like, flow the whole thing together. I talk between songs, you know, I make it as personal connection, drawing entirely from the great experiences I've had from those going to those types of things.
Sure.
Whether it's a, you know, a big star doing an unplugged show somewhere, or whether it's just someone who's just very good in my town who's doing it. You know, you learn, and you piece together your performance chops by doing these types of things. Very, very different than what many people who I understand listen to this show, you know, who are bar bands, who are cover bands, you know, that is one type of exchange. There's room for many of them. And the perspective from the music consumer's perspective is a really interesting thing to understand. You get what I'm saying about how they go to a bar and that's one type of experience. And some people like that, you know, depending upon where you are. There's nice bars, there's dive bars, there's safe bars, there's less than safe bars, depending upon where you're playing.
And they can all be fun to play. Right. Depending on who your audience is and the kind of music you're playing and how you really, but it's, and I think this is what you're trying to say, is you have to, at some level, understand what your crowd is expecting, but also you have to craft that, right? Like you have some leeway there to decide, okay, like, this is the type of show I'm going to put on. Now, you know, you pick the wrong venue for the wrong type of show, things might be a little weird. Like if you guys got up and it was just you with an acoustic guitar the other night at that, like, dark, loud rock club with people that were really drunk, that maybe wouldn't have gone over quite as well as bringing in a 10-piece band, you know, and rocking the night away. Right.
Absolutely.
But you create that vibe with your band or your solo act or your acoustic trio, whatever it is, like you're part of that, but it requires understanding and even setting the expectation in advance. Right. So that people, people know what they're coming to get. And yeah, absolutely. Absolutely.
I wouldn't even say you can shape that. You have to shape that. You have to own that. I mean, I think, and that's part of the thing. Right. So if we go on the basic premise that, you know, having a fan base is a good thing. I think sure, we can all agree on that. I mean, I think there certainly are certain types of musicians who are sidemen who just wait for the call. But, you know, in most cases, I think if you're in a band, you want your band to have a fan base. If you're a front person, you want to have a fan base. If you have several projects going on, you want to have a fan base, and you want to continually nurture that fan base. And I just find that when I put myself in the shoes of those who come to see me, like I said, club dates are an interesting thing. And I would hasten to say that at any time, there's a certain percentage of, so we play this one club regularly and it holds about 200.
Okay.
And if I was just to draw some big numbers about that, there's probably 40% of the people, I don't know them, they don't know me, you know, they're out,
sure,
they're out for a club night, right?
Yep.
I'd say, but that leaves 60% of the people that I have some kind of a connection with. Of that, some percentage of the people are kind of like, well, I know Paul, I know the House Rockers, I know, you know, that they play in decent places. It's safe for me to go there, especially if you're a woman. It's safe for me to go there. You know, I won't get bothered too much. I can enjoy the music and just, you know, it's always a fun time. They're nice guys. They put out good energy.
Sure.
You know, that's a nice time. And maybe I'll dance one or two. That's cool. And then there's some people who, like, are really into, you know, dancing to the House Rockers. They look forward to that. Understanding the needs of all those people helps me shape the show. You know, knowing that there's 40% of the people who don't know me, I can't, I can't be too specific and familiar.
Right.
140, you know, but I need to demonstrate that my show is about connection, you know, like we don't play and not acknowledge the audience. We don't act like you're not there. You know, we're not, we don't think we're background music. So we, you know, that's part of how I front the show. Right. And then again, for me doing all these other things, these solo things, you know, when I do, you know, a coffee shop show, I say, one of the things I say pretty regularly is like, you know what, I play in this awesome band called the House Rockers. And you know, those who know the House Rockers will applaud, which is kind of fun for me. But you know, that's a big noisy band. So I like to do these solo acoustic things and mostly get a little bit more mellow and kind of find those types of songs and express that stuff. And I've just shared a little bit about who I am, you know, how I come to do what I do. And those kind of connections I think are meaningful. Again, if you're a consumer of music, and I'll think about most of the bands, right? You know, what I find is there are many really good musicians in my area. There are some really good front people. Most of the bands and most of the front people are kind of the same. You know,
yeah,
how sure. You guys doing tonight? That type of thing, right? I don't find a lot of people that intuitively reach for that connection with their audience in the appropriate way, in the appropriate place.
That's the key. Is I think it starts with sharing a part of yourself. Either, I mean, hopefully it's a genuine part. It doesn't need to be the entirety, right? You don't need to get on stage and say, you know, hi, I'm Dave. You know, right. My parents got divorced when I was 7, and like, I mean, that starts getting weird, right? But you need to share some relevant, again, hopefully genuine, although I've seen lead singers do the non-genuine thing and some pros are really good at it, but
really good at it.
Really good at it. But, you know, something that appears genuine, right? Which for most of us is easier to do if it actually is. And be open, right, to the crowd and just open the experience. And I've found there's some tricks to that, right? One is doing exactly what you do. Like, I'm Paul and I, you know, I have this other thing that I do that's relevant to this, you know, but different. But in the same breath, you're saying, but I really like the contrast that I have here with you tonight, right? Making it special.
With you tonight.
The Sammy Hagar trick, right? Because he will convince you, even though you hear me say this to you, you'll go see him and he will still convince you that the show that you're seeing is the best show that band has ever played. You're the best crowd the band has ever seen.
That's,
you know,
magic.
It's the best night of the tour. And of course he's lying. I mean, he has to be. But the thing is, I think he believes it in the moment when he's saying it, you know. And it's joy that he happens to communicate. Now, there's some singers like, you know, Morrissey. I don't know that he ever communicated joy, but it, you know, he connected with people. And so it doesn't always have to be the same thing. But yeah, right. You have to share yourself. Another trick that I've found is when the band can have a conversation, either, you know, musically or, you know, with facial expressions or just on the microphone, you know, briefly between songs or whatever, that allows the audience to see in a little bit. Right. And opening that door just a little bit makes it fun and makes it interesting and makes it not like watching TV. And
for sure.
And that's yeah. So it starts with sharing, you know, sharing something again.
Well, hopefully I think a lot of the things that you said are really useful. So you have to be present. You have to be in the moment. That's really the essence of that bond, is like, I'm here and you're here. What are we going to do with this time together? Right.
Let's do something together. You stare at me while I stare at my shoes and play my guitar or play my drums or whatever.
And that's it. Again, you're right. There are certain enigmatic personalities that sell that. And they sell it because that's their truth. It's so painful for them to get these words out or to perform this music. That's what people are buying into. And there's a intuitive understanding between performer and audience that's the exchange that's going to happen. But for most of us, you know, certainly in the cover realm, I mean, if you're in the original realm, you got to find a way to sell your truth. But if you're in the, you know, if you're in the cover realm, I don't know. I'd say it'd be pretty hard for you to find to be
brooding.
Yeah, but, you know, to sell that. I mean, maybe. I mean, there are Morrissey cover bands. I would imagine that you know, Morrissey tribute bands, the Smiths tribute bands, right?
Yeah.
So you know, there are, you know, certainly.
Are there though? I mean, I don't know. I mean, you say that like it's some universal truth that there must be, and perhaps someone has tried. So sure, there are. I don't know that would be overly successful without having Morrissey on stage. Although there are Doors cover bands that, you know, that work just fine. But, you know, and that guy's, you know, another weird personality to sort of try and emulate, if you will. But yeah,
and very, very hard. So, you know, I'm a huge Ryan Adams fan. I love Ryan Adams. I think he's prolific. I think his voice is beautiful. I love the very subtleties he has in his self-taught guitar playing. I think he's wonderful. He's pretty brooding in general,
yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
You can't be that if you're not that. Like, so I get the allure of, you know, this music means so much to me. I want to emote this same feeling to someone else. I'm going to get into my Ryan Adams mode right now. Hard. That's pretty hard to kind of like channel that if it's not truly who you are, even if it's affecting you as a musician and you're drawing an influence of it. If you're not a brooding cat, it's pretty hard to sell that you're a brooding cat, you know?
Yeah, it comes across at best
affected.
Correct. It, you know,
yeah. Trying
that's
too hard.
At best. Right. Yeah. Yeah, that's tough. Yeah. If you're in a cover band and you don't already know that you're a master of delivering the brooding message, don't try. I think is good advice. So
yeah. But I think a lot about it. I mean, I'm kind of thinking about the people who have come to some of these shows and the reaction that they get to. I don't have to go to a bar. I can sit there and this person who I've already bought into that I like them.
Yep.
I like what they do. I like how they sound. You know. They're just going to let it wash. It's just going to wash over me. I don't have to, you know, fight drunk people, you know, trying to get a drink or trying to, you know, pick someone up or anything like that. I can just sit here and let it wash. And this is why I say, I think this type of thing is really good for a scene. I think if you're a leader of a cover band, these are really good activities that pay a lot of dividends. It pays dividends on your performance chops and honing your performance chops. It pays dividends in that it's an interesting thing in your town, your community, to do different than just another bar gig, which is like most communities have bars and bar bands and bar gigs. What most communities, I don't think, and many communities have original music scenes, and that's its own kind of vibe.
Yep.
If you live somewhere in the middle of those types of things, this concept of doing something, and again, we've done it literally just because I wanted to play Tom Petty music and I love to play Bruce Springsteen music and Steve loves to play Fogerty music, you know, but it doesn't have to be that. It can be like, you know, Dave, you know, in a 70s state of mind and, you know, whatever theme you can put together, or, you know, I do these PK and Friends, you know, classic rock nights, the same type of thing. It's, you know, you find whatever your
Dave
your
in a 70s
is.
State of mind. So that means I've got like striped pants and an Afro wig on. Is
whatever
that
it takes, man.
Okay. Hey, I'm just trying to put the visual together here.
A little polyester.
A lot of polyester, both in the wig
big
and
hair,
the pants.
Big
right.
hair.
Yep, exactly.
But like what I'm saying, you know, finding these ways to put on these shows. So it stands out different.
Finding venues too, right?
And that's hard.
And it can be the same venue, right? I mean, it's possible that a venue that could host like a rock gig could also like put chairs in and host something like you're talking about, where it's a tribute night and it's meant to be listened to as opposed to, you know, just like a band playing at a bar. But you've got to, again, it's like we were saying at the beginning, right? You have to know what you're doing and you have to communicate that not only to, you know, to the crowd, but defining it means also working with the venue so that they're getting on board with the expectation of, okay, this is how this is going to work. And some venues are the right venues and some aren't, and that's okay. Yeah. And you got to find the right places there too. Yeah.
Well, I've done two of my three Springsteen shows, and then Steve's Fogerty show was at a local venue, really cool, called the Art Boutique. It's a music hall. Well, actually, it's a comic book store in the front, and then it's a music hall in the back that seats about 160. So just a really good sized space and beautiful big stage, nice in-house sound system. And it's funky, and the funkiness actually adds to the vibe of these shows.
Right.
I've done them in the bar that we've done club dates in, and that's harder because those shows tend to take on the vibe of that bar, meaning there's a big bar and, you know, people are bellying up to the bar and, you know, that type of thing. So you got to be careful, but again, be creative. You know, like, you can find places that'll rent you chairs and, you know, bring things in, and you can rent stages and you can rent sound systems. I mean, you can turn a lot of interesting places. Mm-hmm. And I actually think the venue is a part of the equation here. I mean,
big time.
You know,
yeah.
But, you know, like, you do the church, right? That's an interesting
stone church. Yeah, we've got.
Yeah.
And that place that, as I was saying, there's places that could go either direction. The church really could go in the direction of exactly what you're talking about here. And we've done some shows there where that's sort of the vibe that we've worked to create, as opposed to, like, tomorrow night we're doing, actually tomorrow night will probably go, I'm not sure which direction tomorrow night will go. Cause we're doing another Fling Fest there, but we're starting the night with a few acoustic acts, which we've done in the past and has worked really well. And then Fling will be the electric kind of, you know, end to the night thing. Then we're doing an interesting thing. We decided we're going to do rock blocks, right? So, or double shots. So we're going to do two songs by any given band, and that's the only thing we're going to do all night, including Fling songwriters. So we'll do, you know, two Russ songs and two Mike songs and two Aaron songs and things like that. But, yeah. And we're going to get the crowd involved and have them help, you know, select what the next rock block's going to be and that kind of thing. So it should be fun, but the vibe that I think will be created, again, sometimes you got to go with the flow. You know, if the crowd's really up to dance and move, it's like, well, okay, here we are. Let's go.
Yeah.
But this tomorrow night's, you know, kind of in our minds meant to be a little more of a, let's sit and listen and chill and have a,
you and know, you're right. That. Sometimes, you know, the crowd decides which way it's going to go. And, yep. You know, your job is to actually serve that, I think,
totally.
As opposed to.
Yeah,
as opposed to enforce your will on it. Steve did such a masterful job in the Fogarty show. So he set up a screen and he had like a slideshow of like interesting pictures of Fogarty, all the album covers and that type of stuff. Just as kind of a visual that was kind of going on the side of the stage, off to the side of the stage.
That's cool.
And then he also, and Steve is like rock and roll historian. So he kind of told really well thought out, interesting, delightful stories about how Creedence formed and, you know, just kind of the whole career of Fogarty. And he interjected him, not every song. So it wasn't like, you know, song talk. It was like do a chunk and, you know, he would introduce the album and what was going on with the band at the time. I think he had a couple of interjections about what was going on in the world at the time and how it informed the songwriting. And it wasn't too much. It was just the right amount. And it created, you know, a different type of evening for people. You felt you walked out uplifted because the music was so good and the band he put together was really good. But you learned something, you know, you felt like you understood why this music is so important to people and why it's lasted so long.
Yeah.
And, you know, the whole net of it was really fantastic. And again, that's Steve's gig. You know, that's his
thing. Well, even when he came on Gig Gab here, and we'll put a link in the notes to the show we did with him. It didn't take very long for, you know, the three of us to devolve into, you know, the nuances.
College of rock and roll knowledge.
Yes. The school of rock knowledge. Yeah. Nitty gritty of, oh, who played on this album? And did you know? And yes, I knew, but did you know this? And like that, the rock trivia, right? You know?
Yep.
So that's who he is. And like you said, like that's him communicating his genuine, like, but it's an interaction. It's an interesting thing.
It's an interaction.
Yeah. It's an interaction. Hopefully it's interesting, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool.
But I just want to say, you know, like you doing your special Fling Fests are really good. I think they're, you know, they're good for your soul to do them and they're good for your soul to just, you know, to give this gift to people who are interested.
Yeah.
It's good for them. You know, I'm finding not much price sensitivity. So we were $15 in advance, $20 at the door, not much price sensitivity. And we're $10 at the door for most club dates. So, you know, there's a financial part of this that's kind of cool. The creative part of it is really cool. I mean, it's just so freaking fulfilling. I posit that it's really good for your music scene. It's like,
you
know, there are a lot of bar gigs, you know, there are a lot of bars and a lot of towns and a lot of bar gigs and they do what they do. And people who are predisposed to loving that stuff are going to seek that stuff out. There are music consumers where bar gigs are intimidating things. They'll come and see me play an acoustic show and they'll come see the house rockers outside in a festival or a fair, but they will never step foot in a bar. And this is yet another way to, you know, further that conversation with your audience.
That's a really interesting thing that you said. You know, for some people, bars are intimidating things. And it's important to remember that, right? Because as musicians, there are a few places where I feel more at home away from home than at a bar, right? You know, I'm really comfortable in these kinds of places because I've played, you know, hundreds of them. And
wait a second. Are you as comfortable on the other side of the drum kit, though? Like, would you go to a bar just to hang and listen to another band?
I did the other night because my friend's band was playing, but
a little bit of a different situation.
No, it's totally different. But even still, I'm comfortable. I know how to be in one of those places, right? I know how to sense when, like, things are moving perhaps a little too violently over there, and I'll take three steps this direction. You know what I mean? But, like, I it's not an uncomfortable place for me. In fact, the greatest level of discomfort that I have, and of course, this bar was it was transformed into a party where this particular issue wasn't an issue. But my biggest issue when I go to bars to see friends' bands play is I forget to pay for drinks because I go up to the bar and it's like, oh yeah, you know, like the band usually gets free drinks, or at the very worst has like a band tab going or something. And, you know, but I've had it happen a couple of times where somebody's like, are you going to pay for that? It's like, oh crap, sorry. You know? And then I pay them and tip them well and apologize. It's not intentional, but that's like the most uncomfortable thing that happens to me at bars is that kind of like, oh yeah, it's like, this isn't my night. This is someone else's night. I have to respect that there are boundaries that normally I don't even think about, you know? And so, it's like, other than that, yeah, I'm comfortable there, but you know, not, that's not the case with everybody. Right. And we as musicians have to remember that bars can be very intimidating things for people. They're dark, they're loud, they're no place to sit. There's drunk people spilling beer. Like you could easily describe a bar, as I just did, as a very uninviting atmosphere. And for many people, that's exactly what it is. So to create a vibe where it's not a bar and people can, you know, have a seat and they don't feel like that they're doing something awkward, that's how it's going to be. And the music's not overly loud and it's not terribly dark and all that stuff. Like that can be a really, you know, that can help expand your audience too. And at some level, like you said, perhaps a more financially viable audience as well. So,
yep.
Yeah. Yeah. It's good
stuff, man.
Cool. You got anything else, brother?
I do. I just want to send a congratulations to the lovely Skylar Hamilton for graduating high school today. You got a big thing going on in your family, Dave.
We do. It's a very exciting thing. Thank you for that. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Yeah, it's pretty cool. It's pretty cool. You know, everybody says, you expect to break down into tears and all that. I mean, whatever. I cry all the time, you know, mostly listening to music. But, this isn't a sad thing for me. Like, I'm really excited for her. This is cool. You know, she's accomplished this thing and then it's time to, you know, do the next thing, which I think is pretty cool. So
it is. It's just like, you watch your kids go through these passages, you know, that, and you're happy for them and you're excited and you reflect on yourself and, you know, it's kind of part of what makes us human, I think.
It's totally. Yeah. No, I'm very excited. It's pretty cool. That's pretty cool.
Well, wish her the best from the entire Gig Gab community. All right.
I will do that. Thanks, man. All right, bro. Well, everybody, that's what we got for you today. We will, we'll be back next week, no matter what you're doing. Well, when you're on stage, you don't necessarily want to do this off stage, but on stage, always.
Always be performing.
That's it.